Applying synthetic and organic fertilizers can increase yields, and increased crop yields add to a grower's income. However, because fertilizers cost money, a grower must use the amount that is most profitable. If too little is applied, the most profitable yields will not be obtained. Similarly, such fertilizers can stimulate healthy growth of turf, flowers, or trees. But if a grower or gardener or golf course manager applies too much, nutrients can run off into streams or leach into groundwater, creating environmental problems. The most severe losses of nutrients into the environment occur when fertilizers or amendments are applied in excess of plant needs. How does a soil user know how much fertilizer to apply for the best return at the least environmental risk? Sampling the soil and testing the sample or testing samples of the plant itself can provide answers. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video covers why soils are tested, collecting soil samples, and interpreting soil test reports. There are several reasons why you should test your soils before planting and every few years after that. The first thought is if you have a current nutrient deficiency. Testing the soil will let you know the current status of the soil and if there is a deficiency causing a problem in the crop. Testing your soil will also help you create an economically efficient fertilizer program. By knowing the pH of the soil and the current level of the soil, you can create a program that is just right for the crop. This will avoid environmental problems from fertilizing. In Florida and many other areas, there is ample phosphorus in the soil. By additional unnecessary phosphorus, there is more of a likelihood for the phosphorus to run off into a water body, causing algal growth and pollution. Testing the soil will also help avoid other nutrient deficiencies. For example, if you overapply nitrogen for palms, it can cause a potassium deficiency. Plant growth and health, crop yield, and chance of nutrient pollution relate to nutrient levels of the soil. Fertilization is most profitable for soils in level 1. Most public labs recommend fertilization to sufficiency. At level 1, the nutrient is clearly deficient. Plant health, growth, and productivity are affected. After the missing mineral is applied, growth response is strong and profitable. At level 2, a critical level is reached that satisfies plant needs. More fertilizer may increase yield slightly, but not enough to pay for fertilizer. Growers may fertilize to replace nutrients lost in harvest. At level 3, nutrient levels are high, yields are maximum. Additional nutrients would be stored in the plant, luxury consumption. Fertilizers could also shift the plant to level 4 or contribute to water pollution. At level 4, nutrient levels in plant tissue are so high as to be toxic, or an excess of one nutrient induces a shortage of another. Yields decline. This level presents great potential for environmental pollution. Growers can use three methods to find nutrient shortages in plants. Visual inspection of crops for deficiency signs may uncover clear shortages. Unfortunately, this method notes only critical shortages after yield damage has occurred. In addition, visible symptoms may be unreliable. Chlorosis, for example, may result from low nitrogen, nematode feeding, dry or salty soil, diseases, or other problems unrelated to soil nutrient levels. Deficiency symptoms are also very species dependent. That is, a shortage may look very different on one plant than another. This complicates visual diagnosis, nor does visual inspection tell us how much nutrient to apply. Soil tests measure nutrient levels in soil as well as other soil features. Growers depend on these tests to determine lime and fertilizer needs for crops. Soil tests have limits, however. Conditions that affect nutrient uptake, such as wet soils, cannot be detected in the laboratory. Tissue testing measures nutrient levels in plant tissue itself. This type of testing may uncover problems that soil testing misses. In a broad sense, soil testing is any chemical or physical measurements that are made on soil. In common usage, the term means rapid chemical analysis to assess available nutrient status and pH of soil, including interpretation and fertilization recommendations. Four separate activities are involved in soil testing. In soil sampling, the grower, gardener, turf manager, or greenhouse manager samples the soil and sends the sample to a testing center. In soil testing, the laboratory tests the sample and obtains raw numbers. For interpretation, the laboratory interprets the numbers in light of prior research results, such as yield trials at different nutrient levels. For recommendations, the laboratory issues a report with the results and recommendations for the grower. Let us first look at soil sampling. Soil laboratories use the most modern testing methods and tools. However, the material to be tested is the sample provided by the grower. This means that test results are no better than the sample itself. Frequency of soil testing depends on the crop and how it is grown. For most annual farm crops, sampling every 2 to 3 years should be adequate. Intensive crops such as fruits or vegetables benefit from annual sampling, and greenhouse crops are tested even more often. Soils should be tested before any crop is planted that occupies the soil for longer than one season, such as turf, trees, or perennial forages. Any change in cropping practices should be preceded by thorough soil testing. For example, if a grower intends to shift from regular to conservation tillage, the soil should be tested before the first year. Land should be divided into sampling areas of uniform texture, topography, and cropping history. For example, a coarse textured field should be sampled separately from a nearby fine textured field. Sampling areas vary in size from a homeowner's garden to a maximum of 20 acres on farm fields. In practice, uniform areas seldom exceed 10 acres in size. Some labs recommend using a soil map to determine sampling areas, keeping cropping history in mind. For field crops grown by conventional tillage, herbaceous perennials and vegetables, the top 6 to 9 inches of soil should be sampled. Sod or pasture need only be sampled to a 2 to 3 inch depth. Tree crops, on the other hand, may need to be sampled as deep as 18 to 24 inches. For each sampling area, follow these procedures. When taking soil samples, up to 15 subsamples should be taken at random locations. Avoid sampling low spots or other unusual areas. Sampling areas could be in farm fields, nurseries, lawns, or even greenhouse benches. Augers or soil sampling tubes are convenient sampling tools. A spade can also be used. Dig a V-shaped hole, remove a 0.5-inch slice from the side of the hole, and shave away most of the sample on the blade. Scrape away surface litter at each testing spot and remove a sample of the soil. Mix these samples to form a composite sample and remove about 1 cup of soil. Label the composite sample and let it dry in the air. Fill a mailing container with the dried composite sample. Complete the sampling sheet, including the intended crop, production goals, cropping history, and other necessary information. Mail the samples to a laboratory or deliver them to the lab or county extension agent. The sample containers and sheets can be obtained from the soil laboratory or extension agent. The fertility program for greenhouse or container plants is very different from the plan for field crops. Field growers depend mainly on nutrient reserves in the soil, such as organic nitrogen or exchangeable potassium, and fertilize to add the extra nutrients needed for best growth. Container growers, in contrast, use potting mixes that contain essentially no nutrient reserves. Thus, all nutrients the plants need must be supplied by fertilization. Greenhouse or container soils should be sampled before planting the crop. They should be tested periodically during the growing period. The soil should be tested at any sign of a growth problem. In sampling potted plants, the top 0.5 inch of the growing medium, which is likely to be high in salts from capillary rise, is first scraped away. A core of soil is then removed. The core must include soil from near the top to the bottom of the pot or flat. Several containers should be tested, perhaps 6 to a bench, and composite samples prepared. Precision agriculture or site-specific management are terms naming a management system that relies heavily on exhaustive soil sampling. The system recognizes that soil, even over a seemingly uniform sampling area, varies from spot to spot. In the standard sampling just described, we account for this by finding an average condition, but this ensures some areas will be provided more fertilizer or lime or some other input than needed, while other areas receive too little. By more precise accounting for field variation, precision agriculture aims to reduce production inputs, increase production, and reduce pollution. Precision agriculture begins by imposing a grid of smaller cells over a field. While one might begin with a soil map, the grid is formed using a global position system, GPS computer, and geographic information system, GIS software. Composite samples are gathered for each cell, tested, and entered into the computer. Later, with a GPS unit mounted on the tractor cab, fertilizer can be applied at variable rates as it traverses the field using fertilizing equipment at variable rate technology. So far, we have discussed sampling for routine soil testing to maintain proper soil fertility. The photo of the geranium suggests another approach, testing to diagnose a visible problem. Why are lower leaves of one geranium purplish on the other one bleached? Testing can help provide an answer. For diagnosis, soils hosting affected plants, perhaps part of a field or some of the pots in a greenhouse, should be compared to soils with unaffected plants. So one should collect separate composite samples from unaffected and affected soils and submit them to the lab separately. The results can now be compared. This procedure is best if validated by tissue testing. There are two basic ways to test soil samples. The oldest method uses chemical reactions that produce color changes. The exact color depends on the amount of available minerals in the soil. The color of the resulting mixture is then compared with known standards, and the amount of nutrients read from the standard. Simple chemical tests are easy to use, but not fully reliable. One problem is the human element, because results are based on technique of the tester and what he or she sees. Modern laboratory testing follows a basic two-step procedure of extraction and measurement. The sample is not tested directly, rather various liquids extract acidity, potassium, and so on. Different labs use different extractants, selecting the ones best suited for the region they serve and the situation. No method extracts all of what is being measured. A relative sort of value is obtained. Different extractants displace different percentages of the nutrient being measured. So keep in mind that different labs obtain different values and results cannot be directly compared. Few testing labs routinely test for all 14 mineral nutrients. Rather, a lab offers tests useful for the region it serves. A standard series may include the following or more. Texture is determined by field test or by mechanical analysis. Organic matter is measured by comparing soil color to known standards or by heating the sample to high temperatures, reducing organic matter to ash and weighing the difference. pH and buffer pH, if called for, are measured with a pH meter. Phosphorus is extracted by a variety of extractants. The resultant number represents available phosphorus, not the total of all soil phosphorus. Different tests are selected depending on the situation. Potassium is washed from the sample with a solution that replaces it on cation exchange sites. The resultant value represents exchangeable potassium that is reasonably available to plants. This soil test report shows raw test numbers, interpretations of those results, and recommendations for fertilizer and lime. Some numbers, such as percent organic matter or pH, are fine as is, but the raw numbers for nutrient contents have little meaning until they are tested or calibrated against actual crop growth. Different reports may be issued for different types of clients. The homeowner report differs from one issued to a farmer or a greenhouse grower, reflecting their differing needs. Note that nitrogen is missing from this series. Nitrogen changes so quickly in the field that nitrogen tests are not considered useful in many situations. In such case, nitrogen recommendations are based on the crop. Growers may do a certain amount of their own soil testing, a commonplace practice for greenhouse growers. One might use simple color test kits. A number of relatively inexpensive simple electronic devices such as pH and EC meters are also available, like those being used in the photo. EC meters measure salinity, but because fertilizers are salts, can also infer fertilizer levels in potting soils. Devices for measuring nitrates, potassium, and phosphorus are also now available. These devices allow inexpensive, frequent, and timely in-house testing for crops that need close monitoring. Most often, growers mix one part medium with two parts distilled water, 2-to-1 extract, let it sit for half an hour, and then filter. The liquid is then tested with the devices. The newer pour-through method involves pouring a certain volume of distilled water through the soil in a pot and testing this extract. Either way, raw results have to be interpreted in light of prior research on what the numbers mean. There are charts available for the purpose. Keep in mind that these procedures are not the same as those used in soil testing laboratories, and values cannot be directly compared. Plant tissue tests in combination with soil tests give the most complete picture of nutrient status in the plant. In tissue testing, nutrients in the plant itself rather than nutrients in the soil are tested. These tests are useful for smoking out trace element problems and may be more reliable than soil tests. Tissue tests may distinguish symptoms of nutrient problems from disease or other problems. Tissue tests may also indicate if some soil condition is hindering nutrient uptake. Some growers employ tissue testing to test the effectiveness of their fertilizer programs. Plant tissue tests are also very useful for tree and vine crops in nurseries, vineyards, or orchards. Their root systems are much more extensive than those of annual crops. Thus, it is often difficult to determine exactly where feeding roots are and at what depth the soil samples should be taken. Before sending samples to a laboratory, be sure to determine the plant part used and the growth stage required. For example, soybean samples are collected from fully open leaves at first flowering. Apple samples are taken from leaves in the middle of shoots 8 to 12 weeks after full bloom. A simpler form of tissue test is the green tissue test or plant sap test. In this test, plant sap in the leaf petioles or young stems is tested for nutrient levels. Portable test kits are available that can be used in the field. Some kits use test papers treated with testing reagents. To use these, squeeze plant sap on the test spots. Other test kits use glass vials or spot plates. These tests require bits of leaf petioles to be mixed with a liquid reagent in a vial, and the color is noted on a spot plate. As in tissue testing, several plants should be tested. Best results are obtained by comparing test results from both deficient plants and nearby healthy plants. In conclusion, soil testing is the best way to decide how much fertilizer to use. Soil sampling is the first step in soil testing. Modern laboratories then use sophisticated equipment to measure nutrient levels. Plant tissue tests are used less often, but when added to soil tests, a more complete picture of plant nutrient levels is obtained. Commercial laboratory testing provides more reliable levels, but portable test kits and devices are available to growers for both soil and plant sap tests.